Hi, this is Bud from Integrity Church. I want to welcome you back to another couple of Bud Talks we're doing this week. Happy 4th of July coming up. Want to focus this week on what I'm going to call contradictions in ideology. Now, we're going to get to that. It may take a couple of sessions. It may take a couple more. But I want us to think about what the ideas around ideology really are and what that means. We've talked about that some in the past few Bud Talks. I would encourage you to go back and listen to some of those. And I want us to begin by, again, setting the stage or setting the context for why we're doing these Bud Talks. The real reason that we've begun doing this during the time we've had the COVID and all that, the pandemic and stuff and all that, and some of the other things have happened as well from those events and other events as well, our goal is to help us understand more of what we see at the intersection of current events in society and the Bible, what God's Word says about the Bible. So I will tell you right now, we're going to talk some about biases today. I sort of have a bias, and that is that God's Word is the authoritative means by which I am to live my life, and really the authoritative means by which society is better off when we follow the principles and the precepts of God's Word. So I'll admit I have a bias up front, but that also happens to be the truth that I believe, and a bias can sometimes be built, it can be built on truth as well. It's the truth that I have built my life on. So I want to share with you some things, some thoughts I have about the intersection of that biblical truth and current events and society and what we're seeing today. So I want to backtrack just a little, and I want us to talk for a moment about kind of set in view the horrible killing that we saw of George Floyd a few weeks ago, and the anger, the concern, all that, the reactions that have been so difficult for so many people. Kind of keep that in view for a moment. And while I want to kind of come back to that, I want us to think about the question of what happens when we see injustice occur. What happens when we see people wronged in a very blatant kind of way? And so we sort of began down this trail recent Bud Talks, but I want to dig into it a little bit. I largely see three or four major reactions that we have a lot of times when we see injustice. And there are others, but we're just going to kind of talk about some of these key reactions that I think sort of form the milestones or the benchmarks around this. The first thing that we see oftentimes is simple apathy or indifference. People are not impacted by what they see. They don't necessarily see themselves as a part of that. That's not something maybe they're passionate about, or maybe they just are very much in their own little world of mind their own business and living in this bubble. So apathy and indifference is one reaction. Another one is what I'm going to simply call concern, the word concern. I see this, I'm moved, maybe even broken, maybe even to an emotional reaction such as tears, etc. And I'm concerned. I become increasingly aware, and my mind is drawn to whatever the injustice is and hoping and wishing that something would be done about that. The third, and by the way, concern is constructive. There's no doubt. Concern is constructive. Then the third reaction that I want us to take a look at for a moment is what I'm going to call concerned activism. Concerned activism. This is a situation in which my concern leads me to become engaged in the cause to correct or to deal with the injustice that drives the concern in the first place. So, concerned activism is something that is positive, that is constructive, that is good. And the fourth, and we're going to come back to these, but the fourth reaction is anger. Oftentimes when we see something, anger is that first reaction that we get. My guess is, for those of you who watched the George Floyd killing on the video, that anger was probably something that was really at the forefront of your mind and your emotions at that point in time. Certainly the little bit of the video I was able to watch, anger was the first thing that got to me. Now, let's talk about this angry thing for a minute, because anger is an emotion that can be healthy or it can be unhealthy. Anger can be healthy if it can help us toward solutions. All right, that's the point. When anger is enough for us to say, this needs to be corrected, and I feel like there needs to be a positive, viable solution brought about for it, then it can be very constructive. On the other hand, when anger persists, and we see this a lot when an event causes the anger, but there is an underlying anger that may already exist, or another bias that may exist, that may cause the anger to persist itself. And when the anger never moves into the area of genuine concern, perhaps without the anger, then that is when things can become quite destructive. And so I'll say that in order for anger to get to the place to where it becomes concerned, that there needs to be a place where analytical thinking kind of takes place. There needs to be this cognitive reaction that takes the concern that I have, which is an emotional reaction for the most part, and brings it into the realm of reason. Analytical thinking, what can legitimately be done. So I move to a place of concern where I can either be kind of distantly concerned, depending on the situation, or I can be concerned from a standpoint of activism. I recently had a great phone call with a young lady who totally is activistic in her passion about a certain cause, and it was refreshing to talk to her and understand exactly what drove her and how she sees her calling being laid out in that mode. So I want to illustrate this for a moment and kind of talk a little bit about one of those incidences that we're going to kind of get to in the next couple or few sessions. And I believe that as we look at the reactions to the George Floyd killing, there's a couple of things that we see. You would be in touch with whatever reaction maybe you had when you saw that or when you became aware of the circumstances around this. But I want to kind of take a look at what we see in the mass media today. And I would say that the differences between anger and concern and activism, I think, are all being pretty well illustrated in what we're seeing in all of this. So first of all, I would say that peaceful protests, people coming together and saying racial injustice is something that we should make sure that we are working to eradicate in our culture, is a positive thing. There are legal means by which we conduct protests. We have rights granted in the Bill of Rights and the founding documents for our First Amendment and all those things that are so critically important to the foundation of our society. And so we see a lot of folks who are concerned and they have this activistic concern that kind of engage in peaceful legal protests, etc. Then we see moving beyond concern and activism, we see anger. Anger that persists, anger that does not move into a more productive realm of concern occurring with the destruction of property. And one of the things that we talked about early on, a couple of weeks ago, is the fact that just as our initial actions have to be driven as Christ followers by God's Word, so do our reactions to situations. We are subject to God's Word. God says, don't seek revenge. That's my job in what I do, and that's what you need to understand. So we kind of of property that's been pretty much all over the news. Now, I would dare say that very little of that proportionately is legitimately in protest to the killing of George Floyd. I believe that there are that other factor we talked about, other concerns, other sources of anger that drive people to do things that go far and beyond that which we see in the legitimate protesting of the racial injustice that we saw in the killing of him. For example, one of the things that I'll give you an example of, we're going to talk about contradictions. Here's one of the contradictions that we might see when, and even so, I think destruction of all any property is against God's plan. It's a sin. It goes against God's plan for humanity, and so I can almost see that some anger that might be toward the racial injustice thing. I can see how perhaps that could cause some people to vandalize property relating to the Civil War and the perception of, and obviously the reality of those who led the Confederate army. But when we see statues and monuments and markers that were erected to men like Ulysses Grant, who led the Union Army, and also Abraham Lincoln, who was the facilitator I mentioned the other day of the Emancipation Proclamation, who was the central figure in ending slavery, we kind of know that there's something else going on. And I would dare say that when that happens, when those type things happen, when those types of markers are destroyed, it's not about the racial issue. It's about America itself. And here in the week of the July 4th holiday, we celebrate our independence, to see that going on is pretty deflating and depressing when you get down to it. I do believe that as we have seen around our world, that America is viewed in many circles with a lot of disdain. I believe a lot of jealousy. You got to remember that many people refer to the American founding as an experiment. Why was it called an experiment? Because the way that America was founded, the Judeo-Christian principles that undergirded the founding of America, the free market enterprise, the freedoms that we have, the reason that that was called an experiment, or is today still called from a historical perspective an experiment, is because a lot of that stuff had never been tried in any other countries. And what happened as a result of that experiment was the founding and the growth of the greatest light, I believe, of any nations that the world has ever known. And so with that, I believe that the jealousies, the ideas of not liking the principles that we have espoused as a nation caused many people to hate our country. And as a result, the idea is they want to tear it down, to destroy it, and to change it into something that might look more like other countries around the world. And the problem is we've seen so many other of our fellow nations who are in troubles that result from decaying morality down through the years, and just a continual decline, spending much more money than the nation ever takes in. But we've got our own problems. We have seen, particularly as we've mentioned before, over the past 50 to 100 years, as we've kind of marginalized God, taken him out of the mainstream, we've seen problems pop up and persist, problems that are significant and problems that are really difficult to imagine how we're going to get our arms around those things. But I want to just, for today, just kind of set that expectation, that level of understanding about our natural reactions to injustice. Apathy and indifference, concern, genuine concern, concerned activism, but then anger that stays angry. That is when it becomes destructive and things, the causes of society begin to be torn down when in the aggregate we see things like that we're seeing today, particularly in a lot of the larger cities around our country. So, one of the things I would say simply is that God has a solution for this. And God's solution has always been a repentance folks turning to Him. And as Christ followers, we should be willing to pray for our nation. We should be willing to pray for our inhabitants, of our country. And to recognize whenever we see someone, God loves them tremendously. God loves them to the max. And no matter what they're doing, God loves them. No matter whether we approve of what they're doing, God loves them to the max. And He offers salvation as a free gift to them, just as He does to you and I. So thanks for listening today. We're kind of move a little bit further into this topic as we go a little bit more into looking at the contradictions of society and the contradictions of ideology. Have a great day.